Hey, everybody, I'm Adam Sexton, political director here at WMUR, and welcome to News 9 Politics Plus, where we chat about the week's political news. I'm bringing in my colleague, John DiStaso, political reporter from ensconced in his castle there in New Boston. And John, let's jump right into some discussion of one of the biggest things that happened this week, or big discussion pieces, was this sit-down meeting that Corky Messner organized of potential U.S. Senate Republican candidates to take on Maggie Hassan. This was something that ended up taking a lot of incoming fire, basically, a lot of criticism. What was the outcome that you saw in your reporting, essentially, from this meeting?
The outcome? That's a good question, Adam. That's what we're waiting to see. I don't think there was an immediate outcome. Several of them went into the meeting. Several of them came out of the meeting and went about their business and continued to do the same homework research that they were doing before to arrive at a conclusion as to whether they're going to run. And those who were there, of course, were Corky himself, Bill Binney, who was the host of the meeting at his office in Manchester, Senate President Chuck Morse, Frank Ginta was there, and that was the extent of those who were in the room. Not declining to go was Londonderry Town Manager Kevin Smith, who had a previous commitment, and Commissioner of Education Frank Ittleblue, who I understand just wasn't feeling well. I don't know really the details about why he was not there. You know, what will happen as a result of that? Corky says there will be more discussions. We shall see. I don't know that there's going to be an arrival at, you know, sort of white smoke rising where one candidate emerges as the consensus candidate. I think we will see a primary. And right. If there is not, then we will see a primary anyway, because the general Don Baldick is in this race. But whether there'll be an additional primary among this group remains to be seen.
Yeah, you mentioned the white smoke there. This is the one opportunity you'd be able to use the word conclave in political coverage, probably. You know, Democrats tried to, you know, make some fodder out of this. They really felt like they, you know, had a wedge here to say, oh, there's a closed door meeting. You know, to the extent that people might care or not care ultimately, does this hurt them at all, the eventual nominee, if there's some sort of appearance of, a closed door meeting to decide the nominee?
Well, you know, closed door meetings have happened in the past, maybe less so in recent years, but it's just, this was sort of an open.
That's true. Yeah. People were taking pictures inside.
The door was not open. It was still a closed
right.
door meeting, but
closed
we all
door,
knew
open
what was
window.
Going on, and it was publicized. So the Democrats had a tracker outside. They were filming, videotaping Chuck Morse and Corky and Frank as he went in. Will it hurt? Sure, it'll be a talking point, but ultimately, a year from now, I don't know that it's going to have a major influence on how the voters vote. We'll have to see if there's really going to be if there really is a further discussion. I just think those who are there were there to be polite. Corky's intentions were, I believe, true, and they showed up, they shared some information, they talked about the vulnerabilities of Senator Hassan, who obviously is the ultimate target and probably got less mention than she should have in all of this. And, will this result in, okay, I'm gonna step back and you go ahead, Adam, you know, I'm not gonna run, Adam, it's all you, you know, I don't see that. I think they'll make their own individual decisions based on their own circumstances, money, name recognition, et cetera, all the factors.
Right. And certainly,
does this mean anything? I don't know. It certainly was interesting. It kept us busy for a
few days. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, if there is a primary, I'm sure these candidates will do a decent enough job, you know, criticizing each other that potentially this would be, maybe we'll look back on this and be like, well, what if, what could have happened had they all agreed? But who knows? Let's move on to a very interesting visit that we got from former Vice President Mike Pence, who made a very, busy swing through New Hampshire, several meetings, some that were open to press, some that were a little bit off the record, and, you know, a big speech in Manchester, a big fundraiser. You know, you've been doing this a long time. And I'll offer my observations here in a second. But what do you think about how the vice president or former vice president approached this visit, at least stylistically? We don't usually see when these sort of big-time, big-name people who come out of a former White House, sometimes it's hard for them to reconnect. It doesn't seem like Pence is having that problem here.
It was very retail for someone who is a former vice president. You were on the scene, so you can give me your view as well, obviously. But from what I saw, he was pretty laid back. There is goodwill here. I tried to talk to some of the folks who were very deep Trump supporters to see if there's any hard feelings. Now, obviously, I can't interview thousands of people out there, and there probably are some hard feelings still from January 6th by some who felt that incorrectly that Vice President Pence should have somehow blocked the electoral vote from being finalized, but he couldn't do that. But I talked to Corey Lewandowski and Representative Fred Doucette, Al Baldassarre, who's about as hardcore Trump as you can get, all three of those are, and they felt that there'd be no hard feelings. As for the style of Pence, I think he's laying the groundwork in a very typical but effective way in case he runs, and he's saying all the right things. I know I'm thinking about 2022, which he is, so if he can help a Republicans here, all the better for him post midterm elections. It's something we've seen, as you well know, Adam.
Right.
It happens all the time.
Yeah, I would add in, in my observation, it seems like it's difficult sometimes for, those who are very high up in any administration, a former
right.
vice president or a former secretary of state. It can be difficult for them to sort of get back down to the grassroots level and really, do what needs to be done in New Hampshire in terms of, events that may be small, and that was the event that the former vice president did in Candia. There was a home builders holiday party that was, low key and a nice, few dozen people event, but it didn't have any pomp and circumstance to it. People were enjoying a nice little fire outside and, at Charming Fair Farm. It was kind of a nice rural setting. There was no indication or anything like that this had to be some sort of big event. Pence was right at home, loved talking to people. So it was interesting to see that he has sort of shedded whatever need that any high-level administration person might have for sort of, as I mentioned, that sort of pomp and circumstance. That's generally probably a good indicator for him as he moves.
Did he have the Lamar Alexander plaid?
No plaid. And although, he's being advised by Chip Saltzman, who helped out Lamar Alexander back in '96.
Right. Yeah.
So we'll see if the plaid gets broken out. But, that was, I think he was reminding people less of, the Washington service. And he was telling one person, "I'm a Hoosier." I do want to say one thing about, it's interesting, this sort of dual interpretation or, what happens to Mike Pence based on the anger that he aroused in the Trump base on January 6th, rightly or wrongly. And I interviewed one person at the Heritage Action event. Who had a very interesting reaction. He said, first and foremost, a tremendous respect for Mike Pence. Really thought he did a great job in the Trump administration, but was still kind of frustrated about what happened on January 6th and him not, following the wishes of President Trump to essentially overturn the results of the 2020 election. So, this is it's one of those things where, it's going to be something that everybody's watching, I guess, if he does decide to run for president. It's how he's able to, use that asset of the respect that he has with the Republican base and still with a good chunk of the Trump base potentially versus, whatever President Trump does or continues to do to him message-wise about his dissatisfaction.
Right. And if I could just add, let's say Trump doesn't run and it's Pence, but then there's several other very hardcore Trump supporters, Tom Cotton, just for instance, will these folks attack Mike Pence, claiming that he should have done more to help Trump?
Right.
Will this become will they dredge this up during a New Hampshire primary campaign? Or will this be so far in the past that they'll move on to other issues? I did just want to make one quick point. The Democrats certainly took him seriously. They had a news conference that morning. They were hitting him on the abortion issue, of course. One thing I noticed from your interviews with him, which I know airs Sunday, he's not backing down on the pro-life or really any of his hard very hardcore conservative positions.
Yeah.
So
it all bears watching, and it'll be fun to see how it all plays out, especially since we're probably going to see a lot more of these Republican folks in the quote-unquote invisible primary coming up in 2022. All right, John DiStaso, thanks for connecting with us here from New Boston on News 9 Politics Plus, and thank you, everyone, for watching. Have a great Friday.